I'm excited today for a sort of doubleheader. Not only do we have a wonderful presenter who will be introduced shortly, but we have a wonderful introducer for the presenter. And actually, the relationship with MoMath starts with our introducer. Summer before last, you may remember we had a solar eclipse, and I happened to be in Oregon where Gerard van Belle was giving a talk at the local high school. He works at the Lowell Observatory, and he gave a great talk about what we should be looking for in the sky and what we shouldn't be looking for. And he gave such a wonderful talk that I invited him to MoMath. He came and gave a talk here last May when Jupiter was in opposition. That means it was as close as it comes to the Earth. So many of you may have been here for that. And then through talking to him, I discovered that his father is a mathematician. And so I think it's only appropriate that I let Gerard introduce his father. Welcome, Gerard.
Thank you, Cindy. So thank you all for coming out. Cindy, thank you for inviting me out here, not just once, but twice. I'm glad I haven't overstayed my welcome so far here, and so I appreciate that. It's a real pleasure to introduce my father for a talk. It's not something I've had the opportunity to do before. So if you'll indulge me, I go into a bit more detail than I normally do with a speaker than, if I have a colloquium speaker at the observatory in Flagstaff, Arizona. I'm the comic relief. I get to be the warm-up act, so enjoy that. My father was born in Holland in 1936, so I'm going all the way back to the beginning here. And family folklore tells us that the family had been in the country there for many centuries, though apparently the 23andMe report says we're from Japan. So anyway, the family was mildly dissatisfied with the incursions by the country to the east that happened over the previous three decades, and so they immigrated to Canada in 1949. Manitoulin Island, in fact, I only mention that in passing because it allows me to drop the little Wikipedia tidbit that Manitoulin Island is the largest freshwater island in the world. That's an interesting thing to go look up. They later then went down to the Toronto area, and Gerald's family has a long line of farmers and florists in this particular line of the family, and many brothers and nephews and nieces that are in that line of business. And my father's father, upon seeing his horticultural flair, said, "Maybe you should think about math." And so this is how a career in math was born. And at the same time, slightly after Opa, my father, had come out, my mother, Oma, immigrated to Canada around 1960, and they were married in 1962. I've heard that there are rumors of their scandalous courtship, but you know what they say, you know what happens at the Dutch Reformed Church stays at the Dutch Reformed Church. So my mother is, in fact, a medical doctor, or as my own daughter likes to say, you know, Oma is a real doctor. And Opa and you, Dad, you're fake doctors. So, in fact, her inference from that is that only women are real doctors and men are fake doctors. And my father will say something about sampling bias during his talk. So, it reminds me of a story that after I got my PhD, I was visiting my parents. We got a phone call asking for Dr. Van Belle. And I was very pleased to say, well, do you want Gerald, Johanna, or Gerard? They were trying to get somebody to sign up for a credit card. So I get 5.9% APR now. So anyway, Dad got his master's and then PhD from the University of Toronto in 1967. They had two kids and then immigrated south to Florida, foreseeing the fact that Canada was going to become a liberal socialist hell. And so they got to the south of Tallahassee, Florida. He had a postdoc at the University, at Florida State University. Sorry, I don't mean to confuse that with the University of Florida. And they promptly did an important thing, which is they had an anchor baby, that's me, and stayed in the States ever since. After a second anchor baby, my younger sister, they were off to the University of Washington and had a final child, my younger brother. My parents apparently have a approach to children that's much like going to Sam's Club. You go in for Kleenex, you leave with Stock and Weyerhaeuser, and that's kind of how it worked out. My father's been at the University of Washington ever since. He started off in the Department of Biostatistics. He received the Distinguished Teaching Award there in 1985. He was appointed chairman of the related Department of Environmental Health and Occupational Health in 91. He's now the chairman emeritus. My understanding now as an academic myself is emeritus means you don't have to go home, but you do have to give up the corner office. So he's been a frequent consultant to the FDA and research topics such as sudden infant death syndrome, Alzheimer's, and airborne toxins. He is senior enough that at this point in his career, he's retired many times and has recently been drafted for a number of years to be the principal investigator of the Resuscitation Outcomes Consortium. So he's been a leading authority on many sorts of studies regarding people's healths and different kinds of way that their health gets affected by procedures and that sort of thing. He's written a number of books on the subject. In fact, he's literally written the book on biostatistics. That's the textbook that everybody uses. You might have missed it on the bestseller list at New York Times. It's on the not quite fiction list. So, Statistical Rules of Thumb is another volume of his, and Design and Analysis of the Experiments in Health Sciences. He is a man of deep reflection, careful consideration. He has the highest ethical and moral standards. Those qualities, I'd say, are well marinated with a sense of humor and quick wit. It's very clear that I get my genetics from my mom's side of the family. And with that, I'll have Dad come on up. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Gerard. My wife said, don't say to the audience, I really don't deserve these remarks, because they'll find out soon enough. Would you get rid of your stuff? Here we go. So in a previous incarnation, my wife and I were Randolph and, or Gandalf and Frodo, and that was kind of dull, so I decided to become a statistician. And there is a lot of excitement in the field. My talk is uncertain variation. The title on the poster said certain variation, and that's okay, but I decided to switch it slightly to uncertain variation, and you never step in the same river twice. I would like to think of uncertainty as having two aspects. One, uncertainty as foe, and then there is actually a side to uncertainty as a friend. And I would like to illustrate that at the end of the talk, but I will focus primarily on uncertainty as a foe. Now, before we start talking about specific issues, I think it's useful to make a distinction between variation and uncertainty. So if you set up a little 2x2 grid, you could have no variation, no uncertainty, no variation, uncertainty, and the other way around, and then both. And I will actually focus on the both aspects. But let's look at some examples. So if one talks about the location of Calcutta, clearly there's no uncertainty as to where it is, and there's no variation. Calcutta is where it is. So this is a situation of no uncertainty, no variation. There's a lot of uncertainty about life on Mars. It's either there or not, so there's no variation. But it's clear that we, at this point, we don't know whether there's life on Mars or not. NASA would like to know this, of course, and is spending lots of our money to find out. Finally, there's variation without uncertainty. If you think about the mileposts along the highway, they clearly vary, but it's very predictable, and there's no uncertainty about that. There is uncertainty and variation. And for example, the question, is radiation therapy better than surgery or chemotherapy for prostate cancer? There's clearly variability in survival times of patients, and there's clearly variability in the treatment, and the question is, how do radiation and chemotherapy differ? And that's a question that involves both variation and uncertainty. Now, I'm going to actually illustrate all of this by a balloon activity. All of you should have a balloon on your chair, and there was one person here already who actually did what I'm going to ask him to do. Would you blow up the balloon? Everybody blow up the balloon, please. Blow it up pretty high. Keep blowing. Make it about 13 inches. This is also an exercise in medicine where we look at forced expiratory volume 1 to look at your lung function. I see a lot of good lung function out here, but also some relatively dubious lung function. Now, hold the balloons up in the air. Everybody hold the balloons up in the air. And at the count of three, I say go. 1, 2, 3, go. Now, where did your balloon wind up? It's uncertain. How far did your balloon go? It varies. So this is clearly an example of variation and uncertainty. And there's actually more that could be said about this. So let's think about this just a little bit more. If your birthday is in Friday, if your birthday is in February, pick up the balloon nearest you. Anybody whose birthday is in February, pick up the balloon. Now, all the people with birthdays in February, stand up. Wow. Any more? There are only three people with birthdays, or five people with birthdays in February. Now, the question is, how many of you, there are five people, how many of you have a red balloon? One? Just one red balloon. So, is there another red balloon out there? I can't quite see it. All right. Anyway, you may sit down. Thank you very much. What's the point of all this? Well, when we blew up the balloons, all the balloons in the room, we could call that the population. So that's the population of that we're interested in. Secondly, we had a randomizing mechanism. We blew up the balloons and we distributed them. And where they went, I didn't know, you didn't know, and we still don't know where these balloons went. Now, the February birthday people represent a sample. There were only five people in the room that had birthday in February. And then finally, the color of the balloon is the observation. This is what we observe, and there was, out of the five people, there was one person with a red balloon. Now, this is the kind of model that I want to talk about basically throughout this talk and illustrate how there are little perturbations that really create problems when you try to make inferences about how the balloons got distributed in the room. So I want to talk about uncertainty as a foe. Well, clearly, we just went through a midterm election. The results on Monday, we hope, said something about the results on Tuesday, but we aren't certain. So polling is really a determination of trying to find out what's going to happen on election day before the election actually happens. So we have a population of interest, namely in this case would be the people that actually go out and vote, and then the pollsters try to find out before the election how these people are going to vote, if they're going to vote, and there are all kinds of problems, of course, associated with polling. So polling is one of the problems that we have where there's uncertainty and variation. Another one is, say, time to go to work. Many of you go to work in the morning, and the time that it takes you varies in a variety of ways, depending on lots of things, road conditions, whether you take metro or whatever it is. Homework for class, for those of you still in school. Well, the question is, how long is the homework going to take me? Well, it depends on the subject. The math work may be easy. The English is going to be harder because I've got to write an essay. So the length of time that it takes me to do the work depends very much on the assignment. And then lastly, just for the sake of argument, success for cancer treatment. We have a son, Gerard's brother, who currently is undergoing therapy for colon cancer, and our question is, how well is the treatment going to work? From a statistical point of view, what is his survival time like? Can we estimate that? Well, it depends on many things. Depends on the where the cancer is, depends on the degree of the cancer, and so on and so forth. There's a lot of uncertainty in his case, and then there's a lot of variability from person to person who has colon cancer. So some live long, others don't. So that clearly is a very important issue for us, and for you probably in your situation, there will be situations like that as well. Now, Alfred North Whitehead of Whitehead and Russell wrote a book called Science and the Modern World, dated to 1925. It really was a great book. I just love the book. I read it over and over again. My copy is kind of falling apart. And he said, first of all, that observation is selection. And that's clear what we had with the balloon experiment. We had five people with birthdays in February, so that's already a selection. And then we he also notes that the things directly observed are almost always a sample. So what we have is, in this particular case, a sample of five people, and only one has a red balloon. If I'd asked for people with birthdays in June, another group would have stood up, maybe bigger, maybe smaller, we don't know, and they would have had some set of balloons, and they might have had three or four red balloons, who knows. So the whole point is that we have a sample, and what we're really interested in is what can we say about the population? That's the key question of statistics, and that's the key question for many situations involving life. So observation is selection, and selection creates uncertainty. And the key question is, where does the observation come from? And we talk about that as being the population, the sample space. In more philosophical areas, they talk about a universe of discourse. So that basically talks about the area that we want to be discussing. And the question always is, how selected? And the only thing, if you take away one thing from this talk, then I would say the question is, anytime you have an observation, you should instinctively and immediately ask the question, where did the observation come from? What is the origin of the observation? Because I'm probably not too interested in the observation, I'm more interested in where the observation came from. And so that also raises the question of selection. And what I'm going to do is, I'm going to illustrate this by means of six stories, okay? So the first story is a war story. I lived in the Netherlands during the Second World War, and I remember the planes coming over from Britain making bombing runs into Germany. And I also remember that they didn't restrict themselves to bombing runs in Germany, because the city where I lived, which was Enschede, which was just inside the Netherlands, adjacent to the German border, was what was called a secondary target. The secondary target was that if they missed the target, the main target in Germany, then they would unload on secondary targets. And the reason my city was a secondary target was that there was a large airfield right next to the city. So that's the place where they would also drop the bombs. And the problem was, accuracy was not exactly very great, because I suspect that these guys flying back said, drop this stuff and let's get the hell out of here, you know? So anyway, so one personal story on that is, my mother took my brother, Peter, Gerard's uncle, to visit her father in the hospital. And they get outside the house about a block, and all of a sudden there's a plane or planes that are dropping bombs. Usually there's enough warning, there was no warning. So my mother took my brother Peter, threw him against the wall of the house, and laid on top of him. And the air raid was over, and she stood up, and he couldn't stand up because he was too excited. He had his calf was cut in half, and to this day he limps because of that. So he had a very distinct experience of the war, which he carries, you know, to this day. Well, anyway, sorry for getting a little emotional there. The question to the the allies was, how can we reinforce the planes that so that they have greater chance of coming back? So how can we reinforce these planes? So they assigned it to a statistician named Abram Wald, who was a Hungarian mathematician that had fled to the United States in 1938. And he was with what is called the Statistical Research Group during World War II. And very, very well-known statistician and mathematician, actually. He was a graduate in mathematics. And he's the founder of operations research and sequential analysis, for example. Now, these are the kinds of planes, these are pictures of planes that returned to the airfields in Germany. Here's one, and here's one. I find it quite amazing. This plane was actually repaired and flew again. So the idea was that you would take the profile of a plane and find out where the plane had been hit. And so Wald was assigned the problem of finding out where these planes were vulnerable so that they could be reinforced. Now, he didn't say so, but he said, he basically said, reinforce the planes where they have not been hit. And you sort of say, hey, how can that be? So I want you, as you sit in your row, form groups of three or four and think for a few minutes about why Wald gave that advice. Okay, so just form a little group here, little groups there, and just form little groups and discuss for a few minutes why you think Wald gave that advice. All right. Would anybody like to offer a solution? There's one person there. Just wait for a minute and give that person the mic.
Yeah, I sort of have a advantage because I came from the military too. And the thought that jumped to my mind was that these are the planes that made it back. So if they made it back and got hit where they got hit, and on your premise that they could get hit anywhere, then more likely that the places, the ones that didn't make it back, got hit somewhere else too.
Okay. Anybody else would like to offer a comment? Right over here, over there.
You didn't tell us what the sample was and how many planes had the spots in the same place also. And under probability, you know, the topic of the speech here is, you know, you never step in the same river twice. So I have a feeling that the probability of being hit in the same spot probably is fairly low.
Okay. Any other comments? Okay. Well, I'll answer, or I'll deal with the second comment first. Wald looked at about the records of about 500 planes. I don't know how many planes went out on a particular sortie, but that's the number that he looked at. So there were clearly waves of planes that went back and forth. Whether the 400 or 500 were one sortie, which actually happened, or whether that was a combination of sorties, I really don't know. But your answer is, of course, right on. The question is, where are the planes that are downed? And those are the planes that you don't see because they don't come back. So what Wald did was a very mathematical study of where the planes were hit, and assuming an equal distribution over the surface of the planes, he showed very clearly that the engine compartments were the most vulnerable, which, when you sort of think about it, makes sense. So if the engine gets hit, the plane just doesn't come back. But the whole point was that here we have a situation where you have a sample, but the sample is not representative of the population. In fact, it's not even close to being representative, because what we're really interested in are the planes that don't come back. So this is a clear example of a biased sample, and the usual jargon is a survivor bias, because those are the ones, the planes that come back are clearly the ones that survive. So let me show you. Wald wrote an 80-page monograph. So we've talked about that. Oh, before I do, there's no picture in the Wald monograph. He wrote this 80-page monograph, and it's all mathematics. And it's pretty dense mathematics. And Wald never said reinforce the planes where they've not been hit. But that's been basically the story. What he showed was that on his mathematical analysis, which took 80 pages, that the planes that had, that the engine compartments were the ones that were quite vulnerable to having the plane come down. And there were also, he also showed the probability of a plane being downed if it was hit more than once. So that gets back to your point as well. Now here, for example, is chapter 5, which is which deals with the mathematics of the data that he got, and it's clear that it's pretty dense mathematics, but he had a very practical idea in mind, of course, and he came up with the right answer. So now let's go to a polling story. We've heard about elections, and this is the election in 1936. Landon versus Roosevelt. And the Literary Digest was a magazine that had been polling since 1920. By polling, I mean that they would send out sample ballots to a population, and then as the ballots came back, they would tally them, and every week they would start sending them out in August, and they would every week they would sort of tally how many ballots had been returned and who people voted for. So just to give you some idea, in 1928, they sent out 19 million ballots. Now, all of these took a stamp. This is not email. All of these took a stamp. So just imagine the amount of money that they spent on doing that. In 1932, they sent out 20 million ballots. And in 1936, 10 million ballots. And in each year, they received more than 2 million responses. This is big data, even for 1936. Well, what happened? In 1920, they predicted correctly. In 1924, they predicted correctly. In 1928, they predicted correctly. In 1932, they predicted correctly who would win. In 1936, they hit a bomb. Not a real bomb, but they predicted that Landon would get 55% of the vote, Roosevelt 41. In point of fact, Landon got 37. And Roosevelt got 61. And the magazine really had to eat crow. So 2 weeks after the election, they published an article, What Went Wrong with the Polls, and also a picture of the front of the magazine, which they couldn't publish then because they had already made the picture, but is our face red? So they clearly were embarrassed by this complete fiasco in terms of predicting the results of the election. But what went wrong? Well, after all, you know, again, getting back to our example here, we have a population of, you know, suppose we'd had only red balloons and blue balloons in this room. That would correspond to the Democratic and the Republican Party. And what we really want to find out is how are the people going to vote on the day of the election. Well, who did they send the ballots to? Well, they sent the ballots to mailing lists of phone numbers, mailing lists of houses, mailing lists of voter registration. That's how they came up with their 20 million, 10 million ballots. Well, one problem was that in 1936, not that many people had phones. Who had the phones? Well, the upper crust clearly had the phones, and they tended to vote Republican. So this was one problem. Another problem was low response. Even though they got 2 million ballots back, 2 million out of 10 million, 1 in 5. Why 1 in 5? What happened to the other 4? Why were they not sent in? So there was a low response rate. Then there was a problem of non-response bias. So again, who were the people who had perhaps money to put a stamp on the ballot and mail it back? You can think that it must have been the people that had more resources than those that don't, and the p- people that had less resources were typically would vote or were more likely to vote Democratic, and so they missed that particular part of the population. And then finally, one of the problems with this was that they started mailing the ballots in August. Well, just imagine, ballots get mailed back. They have to be sorted, probably by hand. I'm not sure what they did in those days. It takes a lot of time to assemble this stuff. But you know, there's the deadline of pressure. We got to get this magazine out every week. So the third week in October, which was the final issue, the data probably came from the beginning of October. So now they had all kinds of problems. This was a perfect storm. Selection bias, non-response, a change in time. People tended to become more Democratic over time. So by the time that they got the data and published it, they were just way off the mark. And the interesting thing is that the Literary Digest folded 2 years later, just was gone, and because they could never live this fiasco down. And again, so remember, even though you have 2 million ballots in your hand, where did these ballots come from? That's really the key question. And that's the question of the balloons as well. Well, things don't always go for the better. There was one person in 1936 who predicted correctly. Guess who this was? George Gallup. Because he took a random sample of the population. He didn't go by voter registration list. He had people out in the, on the streets picking people at random. He had a very careful randomization scheme, and he predicted the 1936 election right on. Come 1948, Gallup misses the boat. Everybody misses the boat. Why is that? Well, because in 1948, the two key people are Dewey and Truman. Dewey has such a huge lead that in August, because polling is expensive, they decide to stop polling. So Gallup and everybody else, hey, you know, why spend money? Because it takes a lot of money to go out and poll. They stop polling. And what happens, of course, Truman went on his whistle stop campaign, went from the east to the west in 2 weeks in October, and basically convinced enough people to vote Democratic. The Chicago Tribune had a problem. Their pressmen were on strike. So the management was running the presses. There were more problems, but that was the big problem. So these guys, on Tuesday, by 6 o'clock, they had to get the paper ready because it had to be shipped out in the evening. So at 6 o'clock, they said, Dewey's going to win. So a big headline, Dewey defeats Truman. By 6 o'clock in the morning, they realized, hey, you know, we've done the wrong thing. So they sent their carriers out to recover all the papers. And of course, a lot of people laughed their heads off and said, we're not going to give this paper back. You know, they were offered free copies. And they said, aha, this is too good to be true. So that's the reason that the Chicago Daily Tribune has the headline, Dewey defeats Truman. And there's a picture of Truman holding up the paper, Dewey defeats Truman. So that's another example of selection bias. Well, let me tell you another war story. Donald Rumsfeld, some of you remember Donald Rumsfeld, was the Secretary of Defense during the Bush administration during the war in Iraq. And Donald Rumsfeld was, I think, one of the people who was quicker on his feet than anybody else that I can remember. He could just spout off stuff that was just amazing. So he was interviewed at a regular press conference on February 12, 2002, and the question was, there are reports that there's no evidence of a direct link between Baghdad and terrorist organizations. And here is his response.
There are reports that there is no evidence of a direct link between Baghdad and some of these terrorist organizations.
There are known knowns. There are things we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know. But there are also unknown unknowns. The ones we don't know, we don't know.
Excuse me, but is this an unknown unknown?
I'm not
several unknowns, and I'm just wondering.
I'm not
this
going.
Is an
I'm not going to say which it is.
But Mr. Secretary,
I'm right here.
Okay, so let me just make sure that you heard what he said. So he said that, as you know, as we know, there are known knowns. There are things we know. There are also known things. There are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we don't know, but there are also unknown unknowns. And this was so funny that a couple put this to music, Brian Kong and Elender Wall. And let me play this for you. Turns out that Rumsfeld makes a very good point. Namely, you should always ask two questions if data are missing. One question is, are the data missing? But the second question is, why are the data missing? And that's really a very important aspect. And I can show you some examples of that, of course. So if you're late at work because of an accident, statistician would, so your presence is absent. A statistician would say that this is missing at random. It's got nothing to do with your work. Maybe you should have left earlier if you'd heard about the accident, but if you're on your way, there's nothing you can do about that. So this is called missing at random. But there's informative missingness. For example, we know that young voters tend to vote fewer times than older people. There's a pretty clear correlation between proportion voting and age. We also know that young people tend to vote for one party more than for another party. I won't mention which party. But the point simply is that a missing vote from a young person represents informative missingness, because if that person had voted, that might have changed the election. So that would be called informative missingness. Now, I have this little thing about big data that I think is overblown. Big data presents the challenge that, first of all, you often don't even know whether data are missing, and you almost certainly never know why the data are missing. And so that really creates a problem of inference in terms of how valid are the data for the kinds of things that you want to deal with. And think of the Literary Digest example. That clearly was a case of informative missingness, because the people that were going to vote Republican weren't being polled. Well, here I have a genuine fake news story. Let me read it to you. This is from Washington, D.C., not the other Washington. A month ago, President Trump and his son Donald Jr. enjoyed a golf outing at the president's home base, Cabo Delgado. Donald Jr. is a fairly good golfer with an average score in the high 90s. On this particular Sunday, he scored a disheartening 115. His father, ever supportive, said, Donnie, why don't you have a couple of visits with my pro, my treat, and he can teach you some of the finer points of putting. 1 month later, another golf outing, Donald Jr. scores 99. The president says, I told you, my pro really helped you improve your score. Do you agree? Why don't you just have a little discussion with your group and tell me what, whether you agree with the president's conclusion. Any thoughts? Anybody have an idea?
Well, he normally golfs in the 90s anyway, so maybe he went back to the norm. And secondly, you don't really know whether he went to the golf pro.
I'll take the first part of that answer. Any other comments or thoughts?
So, I think that maybe, like, if he was in the 90s, and maybe he accidentally scored the 115 that
okay.
time.
So.
So it's like the same thing. So I disagree.
So it turns out there is in statistics something called regression to the mean. So the 119, as you pointed out, was in fact an outlier. His average score is around 100. And he just had a bad day. So as we also learn from this news, from this genuinely fake news story, Donald Jr. says under his breath, I never went to see the pro. So regression to the mean was discovered by a statistician named Francis Galton, a polymath. And what he did was he looked at the heights of parents versus the heights of children, and he discovered the following thing, that tall parents tend to have tall children, but not quite as tall. If Gerard were to stand up next to me, he's not quite as tall as I am. Similarly, short parents tended to have short parents, but they weren't quite as short as the parents were. So he talked about that this was a phenomenon of regression to the mean. So I would think that in the case of Donald Jr., that this was simply a case of regression to the mean. So you have to be careful, again, when you interpret data, that you don't attribute causes to data that really don't support that particular cause, in spite of the fact that the president says that was the reason. And there is something called the Sports Illustrated jinx. Has anybody heard about the Sports Illustrated jinx? You've heard about it. So the Sports Illustrated jinx is that if you're an athlete and you're on the front page of Sports Illustrated, it's probably because you had the major league batting average, whatever it is, the next year you're going to do worse. So that's simply a case of regression to the mean. And so athletes call this the Sports Illustrated jinx, but in fact it's not that much of a jinx, it's simply a matter of regression to the mean. All right, another story. I received the following email, which gives me a tip to buy certain stocks. I had some money, so I invested in that stock. And a week later, they sent another tip. I invested in that stock that they recommended. And this happened 6 weeks in a row. Every time they sent me things, they were right on. It was really amazing. So in week 7, two things happened. First of all, I received an inheritance of $50,000. Secondly, the company that sent these emails said, well, we've been right six times in a row. If you really want to get our advice for this week, please send us a check for $1,500 for an annual fee. So what is your advice? Should I join this company? What do you think? Discuss briefly. Okay. Let's hear it from the audience.
Thank you. So one possibility could be that people who received this newsletter bought that stock. They themselves drove the price of that stock higher. And every single time it was sort of self-fulfilling prophecy. So it wasn't that they made the right call. They just convinced people to buy.
Any other thoughts over here? Over here.
Or it could be that they just started with lots of people and only continued to send messages to the people they were right on each time.
Well, let me show you a scheme. I'm not saying this. Well, I think it happened. Again, the Whitehead question, I have these six observations. Where do these data come from? Well, consider the following. The company selected 9,600 affluent people. They sent half of them one piece of advice and the other half the opposite piece of advice. The ones that got the wrong advice, they drop. Now that we have 4,800 people, they send half of those one piece of advice and the other half another piece of the advice. The ones that got the wrong advice, they drop. They keep doing this, and I just happen to be in the pot that got advice six times in a row correct. But it was just random. So this is called the Rainmaker scheme, and it's illegal. Don't you start doing that. So anyway, if you do this six times, it leaves 150 people, including me, and they would want $1,500, which is, you know, not bad, $22,000 from 150 people. But there is no reason for smugness. Assume that there are 50,000 financial advisors in the U.S. I think there are more. And each advisor gives you advice 1 week to do this or to do that. How does that differ from the Rainmaker scheme? I think it's identical. So I think you have to be careful that you don't put too much trust in your financial advisor, okay? That's one of the bottom lines. All right, we're moving on. Does your dog bite? This is from a Peter Sellers movie, Peter Sellers, the Revenge of the Pink Panther, 1975. Let's see what we can do here. Here's Peter Sellers looking for a room in Switzerland.
Does your dog bite?
No. Oh.
Nice dog. I thought you said your dog did not bite.
That is not my dog.
So, the question is very important. The question determines the sample space. And so you have to be careful that the question addresses the point that you're interested in. And that brings us back to the sampling story about, you know, have you stopped using drugs, for example? Well, if you ask that at an AA meeting, that's probably appropriate, but it wouldn't be appropriate for this audience. So the question really determines the audience that you're dealing with. And then my final story is a rainy day story. It's raining cats and dogs, and you have to go from one building to the next, and you have this existential question. Should I walk or should I run? Which gives me the least rain? Okay? So that's the question. Now, who remembers this person?
Ann Landers.
Ann Landers. So you can ask Ann Landers any question. Well, this question was asked of Ann Landers. Okay? And she was asked the question, and she said she never got more responses from people than answers to that question. And it turned out that one college gave kind of a nice way of actually answering the question. Some questions were, well, it depends on the rain. As she mentioned, there was some answers were so heavy with mathematics, she couldn't understand the mathematics. She had a hard time balancing her checkbook. So, but one college did the following. They took 20 students and they randomized them to 10 of them either to running or 10 to walk. And before they started to walk, they pasted a piece of tissue paper, wiping paper on their chest. And so one group walked, the other group ran. And what turned out to be very clever, at the end, they simply weighed the paper. And so clearly, the more rain, the heavier the paper would be, and the less rain, the less paper. And the bottom line turned out to be that they, you're better off running. And there are all kinds of permutations of that. If you go to the internet and look up running in the rain, you'll get pages of mathematics. I'm not kidding, because it depends whether the wind is coming from the back, and it depends whether the rain is, you know, well, at a certain angle, and it depends whether you bend forward or not. But all this is really kind of commentary. The bottom line is that the key is that you better run rather than walk. Well, this is an illustration of design. Let me just go back for a minute. And what have we concluded so far? Well, first of all, that if we take observations, they must represent the sample space in some sense. And a lack of representativeness can result in bias. And a representative sample turns out to be a random sample, which simply means that every observation in the population has an equal chance of being selected. So when we go back to the bomber story, every plane should have had an equal chance of being represented in the data that Wald got. And it was clear that there was no equal chance for the planes that didn't return. So if he had had a truly random sample from the planes, then he would have been able to make a much better inference. Well, let me just briefly conclude with uncertainty as a friend. Well, it turns out that uncertainty as a friend occurs in many cases. And in fact, when you think about it, uncertainty as a friend is more common than uncertainty as a foe. For example, all board game, chutes and ladders, or is it snakes and ladders? chutes and ladders. You roll a die. In Monopoly, you roll a die. In cards, you shuffle cards. Computer games, all computer games have what is called a random number generator. So there's a random number that's generated which gives you a certain play or moves things in a certain way. And the random number generator is in fact a generator of uncertainty. So there's uncertainty in all kinds of situations that we're involved with. In sports, when you think about sports, it's permeated with uncertainty. From the trivial aspect, they toss a coin before the football game to find out which side goes which. But think of sports divisions. So you have major league ball, you have minor league ball. And major league ball is, if a major league team were to play a minor league team, it'd be kind of boring because they were always winning. So the whole idea of professional sports is to make things as uncertain as possible. So for example, drafts, the worst team in the league, which gets trounced by everybody, gets the first pick in the draft. Why is that? To make them more competitive, to equalize the probability of winning. Because only if you're sitting at the edge of your seat watching Green Bay play whatever it is, and if the score is tied at the end, you're going to stick through all the ads that come and watch the end game. So the whole idea about sports is to increase uncertainty rather than reduce uncertainty. The coaches, of course, would like to reduce uncertainty, but the whole setup is to increase uncertainty. So those are some of the things that go on in sports. Government has antitrust laws, so you can't have one company have a monopoly. And why is that? Because it creates what is called an equal playing field. So that's another area where you have increased uncertainty because it makes things more competitive. And then in medicine, which is the area that I've been involved with, it happens all the time. When we have a, when we want to study, my last, or one of my last areas was Alzheimer's disease, which is intended to presumably prevent memory loss, among other things. How are you going to judge whether a new drug works? Well, you give maybe one group one drug and the other group a standard drug, and then you compare the memory scores at the start of the study and at the end of the study, and you want to compare those two. And what you do is you then look at, what you want to do is you want to make the two groups as comparable as possible. So what you do is you randomly allocate people to one treatment or to another treatment, which makes the groups comparable. The, there's something called evidence-based medicine, which is a term that came up, I think, in 1978. The idea being that evidence has various levels. There's level A evidence, level B evidence, level C and D. Level A evidence in clinical trials, which the FDA accepts primarily for studies, is evidence of studies based on randomized clinical trials. So if a drug firm wants to submit an application based on observational data only, the FDA is going to be very skeptical. So level A evidence is based on randomized controlled clinical trials, which is a way of making uncertainty equal across both groups. That's how you do that. Level B is very carefully done observational studies. Level D is expert opinion. So if you claim that, well, I know this treatment works because I'm a doctor, a real doctor, and therefore this works, that's level D evidence, which has very little merit in clinical trials. So we have uncertainty as friend, and we have uncertainty as foe. I think that the two actually come together and can be meshed simply by saying that you need equal opportunity. When we talked about the WALT study, what we would want is equal opportunity for every plane to be represented in the sample. That didn't happen. If we can make that, then we have equal opportunity. For uncertainty as friend, we have equal opportunity. So you have an equal chance to be in group one or group two. On a personal note, again, and then I will quit, our son was randomized to a clinical trial. We said, yeah, of course, join the clinical trial for colon cancer. Well, the idea was that there were two treatments. One, there was a new chemotherapy which was supposed to shrink the tumor without radiation. So we said, gee, let's hope you get randomized to that arm. The other treatment was radiation and chemotherapy at the same time. So he went through the chemotherapy treatment for 3 months, got tingling in his feet, could hardly stand. The tumor had grown. So he would have been better off in the other arm, because now we had to go through radiation. And anyway, but at the time of the study, he presumably was randomized by the toss of a coin to either the new treatment or the old treatment. He had an equal chance of being in one or the other. So equal opportunity is the answer to both uncertainty as foe and as friend. And William Cowper sort of said, he didn't say this, uncertainty is the very spice of life that gives it all its flavor. And I'd like to acknowledge again Cindy, Lawrence, and staff for MoMath for having me here, Gerard for his introduction and guidance with audiovisual slides, my wife Johanna of 55 years. 5 years ago she became Frodo, but that didn't last too long. And then you, the audience, thank you very much. And if you have comments, send them to me.
If anyone has any questions.
How are the inferences from big data, currently a popular buzzword, similar to the result prediction for the 1936 U.S. presidential election?
Well, I think the big data issue has the same problem as the 1936 election. Why were they collected? A lot of big data is collected for administrative purposes. And what does that mean? You know, that means that it's not done for science. And so the scientific aspects of a lot of big data is dubious, but you know, that's the way it is. So I think that I'm somewhat skeptical of big data, but that's probably somewhat of a bias that I should not exercise too strongly. Yes?
I'm coming from a engineering background, but in there we were taught about something called Hawthorne effect.
What's that?
We were taught about something called Hawthorne effect, where you make a measurement, sure. Because I'm coming back to your premise or comment early on about every observation is a sample, but then with the Hawthorne thing, it's the effect.
Right.
You have an effect on the result, right?
Right. So the Hawthorne effect was during a factory, I'm not sure where the name Hawthorne came in. It might have been the person doing the study. They had two groups, one that they were going to give sort of one set of encouragement, and the other group another set of encouragement to increase productivity. Well, they found that both groups improved. And the reason was simply that the employees got some attention, and they became more interested in their work, and that's why they improved. And this is really a big problem in Alzheimer's disease, getting back again. There are all kinds of studies that deal with improved memory. And so I've been involved with reviewing grants that that have computer-generated games to improve memory. Well, that's the treatment group. What's the appropriate control group? You can't just let these people be by themselves, because it might just be that giving these people attention, these patients attention, makes them more active and gives them. So the control group in these computer-generated studies is very tricky. And so one thing they'll do is they'll give them reading material. Well, you know, the last thing I knew is to read another thing about Alzheimer's disease if I can do a computer game. Another problem is that if people know that one treatment is computer games, they may say, hey, let's try some computer games ourselves. So the treatment no longer is pure, if you wish, but it's contaminated by another thing. So it's very tricky to give treatments that actually differ without having both have some effect that's simply the effect of any treatment.
So thank you, and let's give a hand to our speaker.